Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Okay, I've got answer as 3. So to the students who have answered 3 degrees of freedom system, I would like you to unmute yourself and let me know why do you think that's a 3 degree of freedom system. Or let me just go through it and then you can correct me if I'm wrong. Okay, so I know that this is my first mass. There is a spring here. I need 1 degree of freedom system to basically represent the displaced position of this mass. Correct? Now I have a spring here. Okay, so I cannot simply say that the displaced or the rotation of this pulley is related to u1 by simply theta is equal to u1 times the radius of the pulley. So for that I need to consider another degree of freedom system. Okay, now I have 1 degree of freedom system u1 and then I have theta1 to represent another degree of freedom system. Okay, now I have this bar as well. Okay, now this bar can also rotate. It is constrained to rotate about this point here. So it can rotate. And is it related to the rotation of the pulley? It would have been had I have a inextensible string between these two. But I have a spring. So to represent the position of this bar, I need to represent another degree of freedom system, which is theta 2. Similarly, the case for the lower bar here, which is again connected to this one by another spring. So to represent this position, I need another degree of freedom, theta 3. So now I have 1 translational u1 and 3 rotational theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. So in total, 4 degrees of freedom system. So now what I would like to do, whoever had answered that there is 3 degree of freedom system. If you have any doubt after this, then you can unmute yourself and let me know. I will try to explain. Okay. Is it clear to all of you? How did I arrive at 4 degrees of freedom system? What if I replace this with a string here? How many degrees of freedom then I will have? If I replace this spring by an inextensible string, then I would have. I have simply reduced 1 degree of freedom system, right? So now my theta 1 and theta 2 are related, isn't it? Do you understand that or not? If I replace this with a string, theta 1 and theta 2 are related. And how are they related? Can I say whatever is the displacement through theta 1, how much it would be? Let us say it is rotating by theta 1. So theta 1 times r is the downward displacement, where r is the radius of the pulley, and the theta 2 would be, so this is whatever is the displacement here is, so this is theta 1 r, and this theta 2 would be theta 1 r divided by this l length here. Okay, so this theta 1 and theta 2 are not independent anymore. Okay, so that's why I need only 3 degree of freedom system, or this is only a 3 degree of freedom system. Is that clear to all of you, all of these examples? If you have any doubt at this point of time, let me know. We would be setting up different type of equation of motion, and it would be very critical for you to understand how many degrees of freedom each system has. Okay. All right. So this was when the systems were composed of springs and rigid system. How about I have a, let me take another example. How about I have a simply supported beam here. Okay, so this I have a simply supported beam here. How many degrees of freedom this simply supported beam would have? Now this beam is deformable. Remember, let me write it here. EI is the modulus of rigidity of this beam. Okay, how many degrees of freedom this continuous beam would have? Anyone? It would have infinite degrees of freedom. So a continuous system would have infinite degree of freedom. Why? If I consider deflection, something like a very generalized deflection, let me say this is u, and if this is represented by x, this would be u of x. And at every point of time, which would be in infinite values of x, I would have infinite number of u. Okay, so a continuous system would have infinite degree of freedom system, and it is usually not very easy to solve that. We will solve some continuous systems as well. However, in general, it is not very easy to do that. So many people, what do? They represent it through a single degree of freedom system, where they lump all the masses at the center of this beam and then say, well, I'm going to consider it as single degree of freedom system. Well, if you wanted, you could also consider this as two degree of freedom system, where you are going to represent this through these two masses here. So now you would need U1, U2 to represent this. Is that clear what I'm doing here? How I'm idealizing this system and representing through different degrees of freedom? And if you make this infinite degrees of freedom, again, you are basically going by this method where you represent it as U of X. Okay. All right. So a continuous, remember that a continuous system would have infinite degrees of freedom system. Okay. All right. Once we have that, let me consider a representation which is also in your textbook and which is somewhat more familiar to people in a structural engineering background. Okay. And we will see different representation of a dynamic system. So let me start with the frame example that we discussed. Okay. So we said that a one-story frame can be represented with a single degree of freedom system. Okay. Something like this. Now, we are going to discuss components of a dynamic system, which would help us in setting up the equation of a motion, equation of the motion. Okay. Now, let me say this is being applied upon an external force PT. What happens if a deformable body, you apply an external force? One of the things that will happen is that it will deform, right? So first, let me consider the stiffness component of this. Okay. So what I'm saying, initially, it was undeformed like this, and under the action of force, it deformed. Now, in the stiffness component, I'm not considering mass yet. Okay, I've said that I've lumped all the masses here. However, when I'm discussing a stiffness component, I'm just saying that I'm applying a load statically, so that I'm just considering only the stiffness component of this frame. Okay, so how would it look like? Something like this. Okay, and this is U. Okay, and let me say the force applied is, the stiffness force is Fs. Okay, clear. So what I want to do is I want to find out the relationship between Fs as a function of U. Okay, so that is my goal here. If I take the free body diagram of this, if I cut this structure in half, okay, I have Fs applied here. So the resisting force would be, due to the deformation of the structure, I would have a stiffness force or the internal force, which would again be Fs. Okay, now let us start with the most or the simplest representation of a stiffness system. If I have a spring here of a stiffness K, and if I apply a force Fs, how is the displacement of the system is related to the K and the Fs? Can I say it is Fs is equal to stiffness of the system times the displacement? Okay. Now I want to do the same thing for the frame here. So the question becomes, how do I do that? Okay. How do I find the relationship between Fs and U? Okay. Now, let us see how do we do that. Before going into that, let me take an example of a cantilever beam here. Okay. So I have a beam on which a force is applied at this end, which is, let us say, Fs. And then I'm representing the deformed position through this U here. So I want to find out the relationship between Fs and U. Okay, before going into the frame structure, can anybody tell me what is the relationship between Fs and U? from your structure analysis course. I hope you remember these are very simple relationships, right?
U equals to FL cube by 3.
Good. U equal to FL cube by 3 EI. Okay. So this is the displacement or the deformation at the free end of a cantilever beam. Or can I also write this as FS equal to 3 EI by L cube times U? Can I do this? I've just rearranged the term. Now, if I want to write this as K times U, can I say for this cantilever beam represented through this degree of freedom, okay, what is KS? 3 EI by L cube. Can I say that? Anybody has any objection to this, what I'm doing here? Okay, this is simple, whatever you have studied from your structure analysis. Now, for this cantilever beam, now let me consider the second case in which I don't allow the rotation of the free end. So initially I had this, so it is basically free to translate at this end, but not rotate. So it would look like something like this. And if you remember from the indeterminate analysis you would have done, if I have a force FS here, and it is displacing by U, what is the relationship now? First one was the easy one. Anybody remember the second one? What is the relationship between FS and U here? Now this is not allowed to rotate at the second end.
12 EI by L cube.
That is the K, right? So the relationship is U is equal to FS L cube by 12 EI. And you can refer to your structure analysis textbook. I'm not going to go into derivation on all those things. Okay, you can pick up any textbook on structure analysis and it would give you how to find this out. Okay, but for this case, I'm just giving you two simple relationships like this. So again, like what I did above, I can write it as FS is equal to 12 EI by L cube times U. So if I have to represent this second cantilever beam as a spring mass system, I would represent it like this with stiffness as 12 EI by L cube. Okay, so just keep these two examples in mind. Okay, of course, these are beams, but if I rotate it, it would be like a column, which is exactly the case here. Okay, I have two columns here, and that's why I wanted to show you these two examples. So now, to find out what is the relationship between FS and U of this frame, not this cantilever beam, what I'm going to do, I'm going to consider two extreme scenarios. Okay, in the scenario one or in the case one, I'm going to say that this beam here that I have, okay, this beam that I have is flexurally very, very flexible. So it does not offer any resistance against rotation. So what I'm saying is EI of this beam is equal to zero. So what does it effectively mean that if my column wants to rotate, remember, if my column wanted to rotate here, what happened? Because this beam was not very flexible or not, it has some flexure rigidity, it prevented the free rotation at the second end of this column. But if this is very flexible, then it is just going to rotate like this. There is nothing to prevent it because the beam, which was actually preventing the rotation at this end, is actually now have zero flexure rigidity. Okay, and then it would look like something like this. Is this representation clear? If beam has zero flexure rigidity, so I still have the total displacement as U. Okay, but IFS is now, if you cut it, okay, it is due to two columns which can freely rotate at it end. So it is somewhat similar to this. So can I say FS would be 2 times 3 EI by L cube times U that I have here. Remember, if this is U, this is also U. Even if this flexurally flexible, have zero stiffness flexure, I still consider I have still considered it to be actually rigid. So whatever the deformation, it is going in the horizontal direction. Same would be deformation at the leftmost end. And because I have two columns, I'm representing Fs as 2 times 3ia by L cube. Okay. So this is the stiffness in this case. Okay. So if I have to represent this as a spring mass system here, I'm going to say this would have equivalent stiffness of 6EI by L cube. Is this clear to all of you? If you have any question, let me know. Okay. All right. If not, then let me just go to the other extreme example in which I consider my beam to be very rigid. Remember, first case very flexible, second case very rigid. So this beam cannot rotate. If it's flexurally rigid, that means that it is you're not able to bend it. So the deformed shape would look like something like this, and the beam would move to its new position. Okay, so beam is perfectly horizontal. You are not able to rotate it. Okay, so this is somewhat replicates the second scenario here that we saw. Okay, and in this case, this is U and this is force Fs. I can represent my Fs as 2 times, I have 2 columns here, 12 EI by L cube times the deformation of the frame. Okay, so in this case, my Ks is 24 EI by L cube. Okay, so these two extreme situations demonstrate how to find out the stiffness of a frame instead of a single member. Okay, and I'm using this concept. Of course, in reality, situation is somewhere in between. It is not either very flexible or not actually flexurally very rigid. It is somewhere in between. So the question becomes then, how do I find that, or how do I find in that case what should be the equivalent stiffness of the frame? Well, there are formula that are available, which based on the flexure rigidity of the beam divided by the flexure rigidity of the column would give you the value of Ks. Okay, so you can go to the book, your textbook, and have a look at that. I'm not going to describe it again here because we are just focusing on the concepts, how we are deriving this spring mass representation. All right, so the stiffness is now clear. Okay, that I'm going to represent my stiffness force in the system by this relationship here. Now, remember, this is for a linear elastic system. Okay, in reality, many of the system, if you keep applying the force or if you keep applying the displacement, let us say even if it is a column or a beam, it will keep on increasing. Okay, and after a certain point, the material will start to yield or fail. Yield if it's steel or another metal, fail if it's like a concrete or something like that. So behavior is not exactly linear. Okay, so although I'm considering it here, this representation, in reality, behavior could be non-linear. So after a certain point, it will start to become like this. And if you do a cyclic loading, it would be something like this. And some of you might have seen this representation, okay, in your book. So this is Fs and U. So this is a non-linear representation. However, one of the assumption that we would be following in structural dynamics, that all these displacements are small. And for a small displacement, let us say this is U, this relationship can be approximated, can be considered as a linear system. So in this course, we would only be dealing with linear system. And some of you might end up taking advanced courses in earthquake engineering or non-linear structure analysis or other type of courses. And there you are going to get into the non-linear part of it as well. However, we are not going to consider any non-linear part of the structure. We would definitely consider non-linear response due to other factors we would see in the later chapter. Okay. Is this clear? Any doubt up to this point? We have only considered the stiffness component of the dynamic system now. Okay. All right. Now let us come to the second thing, the second component. Before that, let me say, I have this mass here, this representation, and the stiffness here, and this is a linear system. And I said that this is elastic. Okay. What will happen if I apply an initial force and let it vibrate? Or what will happen if you take a spring and pull it and let it vibrate? Would it keep on vibrating indefinitely? In reality, anything that vibrates, it won't keep on doing that infinitely. It would come to a rest after a certain time. It might be a small duration, let us say 1 second, or it might be a large duration, let us say 1 day. It depends on what? There is always some energy dissipation. Okay, there is always some energy dissipation involved with vibrating structure. Okay, and this energy dissipation in a structure is represented by something what is called damping. Okay, so the second component that we are going to study of a dynamic system is called damping. We saw stiffness, now let us talk about damping. Okay, so any vibrating structure would decrease or dissipate energy over the time and come to rest after some time due to a process which is called damping, which arises due to energy dissipation in that structure. Okay, now what could be the different sources of energy dissipation? That is important to understand. So in a structure when it is vibrating, or in a system when it is vibrating, there could be different sources of energy dissipation. Okay, one could be, even if you think that you are giving it a small displacement, if you keep on displacing at the molecular level, what happens? There is a friction between the molecules. Okay, and even elastic at the structure or the macro level, it would dissipate energy at a micro level, and it leads to, let us say, heating in the molecule. That's why what happens that if you take a, let us say, any metal, and if you keep, like, you know, vibrating it, after a certain time it will start to get hot. Why is it that? It is because of the elastic straining. So elastic straining is one example. Okay, what could be the other energy dissipation mechanism? So due to elastic straining at the molecular level, you have friction at the molecular level, and it leads to dissipation energy. Other could be, let us say you have a steel frame structure. Okay, now these frames could be either bolted or these could be welded. When this structure deformed, what happens that due to rotation of these joints and the friction as this joint, okay, overall, when I consider even a single degree of freedom representation or a multi-degree of freedom representation, to represent the energy dissipation at these joints, okay, I again have to consider damping. So the other one is, let us say, joints and connections. Okay. There could be other type of, instead of steel building, if I had, let us say, concrete building, which does not have a connection like a steel building, but still, if you apply a force, what happened that concrete has micro cracks. And when you apply a force, these micro cracks will open and close up because of this applied force. Okay, so it could be due to opening or closing of these micro cracks that this would dissipate energy. Okay, and in real type structure, there could also be, let us say, I have window here, I have furniture here, I have, like, you know, a different type of things here. And when the structure vibrates, there is interaction between these non-structural components that are inside the structure and the structure itself. So it is also due to the interaction between, or the energy dissipation due to friction between non-structural and structural component. Sorry for the handwriting, I mean, No, I mean, this is just for explanation. I'm not going to, you should not use this as like, you know, as your notes anyway. So the interaction between non-structural and structural components also leads to some energy dissipation.
Okay.
So there could be different mechanisms of energy dissipation. Now, as you could imagine, it is very difficult to, and like, you know, what is our goal here that we are trying to achieve? Here, we are trying to simplify the system so that we can model it mathematically. But as you could imagine, these phenomena, each of these, are not very simple to model. Okay. So then the question becomes, then what do I do to simplify that so that I can model it as a simple system? So what do? We combine all these energy dissipation mechanism in a single energy dissipation mechanism, and we represent it something what is called equivalent viscous damping. Let us see what is viscous damping is. So although the actual mechanism of damping is different, I'm representing it through equivalent viscous damping. Why? Let us just discuss. Okay, why I'm considering is equivalent viscous damping. Okay, I want you to consider a pond filled of water. Okay, in this pond, what do? You take a flat noses structure or like an object. Okay, and you apply a force here. So you try to submerge this inside this water, which is like a flat at the top. Now, what will happen, you will see that if you try to apply load very slowly, okay, if you, let us say this is FD, if you try to apply load very slowly, this would easily get submerged into the water and there won't be any resistance if you try to do it very slowly. However, if you try and come just like, you know, try to submerge it very quickly, then what will happen? There would be resistance at the bottom. Remember, in both case, there is same deformation U. But what is changing here? In the first case, you are doing it slowly. In the second case, you are doing it very fast. So the thing that is changing is actually the velocity at which you are moving this flat noses object here. Okay. So this was an example of a fluid, but water, but you can take any fluid. And one of the most popular type of fluid is a viscous fluid. Why? Viscous fluid has friction, in a simple term, it has friction between the fluid and the surface, right? And it provides more energy dissipation. So what I consider now for the similar representation, there is a piston. Okay. So there is a piston which is closed here. All right. And this piston is not completely filling up this diameter of this outer perimeter. I have fluid here, a viscous fluid on these both sides of this piston. Okay. Now, as you try to apply the force Fs here, what you will see, if you try to do it slowly, the liquid will come through these orifices at the end of this piston, and FD here. Okay, so FD here. Okay, if you try to do it slowly, FD would be zero if you apply it slowly. However, if you do it quickly, what will happen? FD would have certain value of the force if you do it fast. Okay, so I hope you understand this concept. Why is it not offering any resistance? And this I'm just taking example from the real life. Like this, you can try this experiment yourself.